And welcome to What I Wish I Knew, a series where we uncover IoT implementation lessons, advice, and the occasional regret from the innovators leading the way. I'm Jenny Cady, and today I talk with Finn Mainstone of Siemens Gamesa, an innovator using IoT solutions to build more agile factories, increasing speed, quality, and efficiency. Finn talks with us about how IoT has impacted their business, the role of managing expectations along the way, and the critical importance of really understanding the problem to solve so that you start right, which is half the work.
My name is Finn Mainstone. I'm the Senior Product Manager at Siemens Gamesa, and I'm working on the optical blade, which is a digitalization project that we're working with different departments around the company, but mainly ran out of the Digital Venture Lab, which is a sort of newly set up part of Siemens Gamesa. Digitalization, I mean, obviously that's a sort of global thing at the moment, and has been in progress for a long time, so to speak. But in Siemens Gamesa, this is like quite a hot topic. And this particular product, I guess, you know, blades are somewhat the core of our business, right? We manufacture our blades, you know, we build them from scratch with raw material. So in that sense, anything that we can do to improve our blade manufacture really has an impact to our business. And then you could maybe even zoom out a level further and say, if we have, you know, success in our business, then that makes wind power generally better. If wind power is better and we're able to produce turbines at a cheaper cost, then that brings down the levelized cost of energy, which, you know, has a knock-on effect. Basically broken down into three key categories. These are the problems that we were looking at. You know, we did a very lengthy sort of use case investigation, detailed user stories, et cetera, and all of that boiled down into those three categories: speed, quality, and efficiency. So if I just take them sort of one by one, if I talk about speed, so what this sort of looks like in reality, if you imagine like a sort of Formula One pit stop 60 years ago, you know, they took 2 minutes or something, right? They weren't super safe. Everyone was just sort of making it up as they went along, right? And so what we're looking to do with this is to make just like a sort of Formula One pit stop in 2 seconds or something, you know, change our designs, change our processes, change the way that people work together. Just overall making our blades much faster. We don't release poor quality blades into our turbines. If we have a quality issue early in the manufacturing process, that just equates to extra repair time later on in the process. And that repair time obviously costs us money. So if we can reduce quality defects earlier on in the manufacturing and reduce the repair time later on, this is a benefit to all of us. And then that then I guess ties in pretty much directly to the final point, efficiency. You know, where we have staff working on things in different ways, we have a global footprint of factories across, you know, countless countries. We're spread across all the continents, and so there is a natural variability in how blades are produced, even just between onshore and offshore. So reducing that variability, making sure that each team is able to perform as well as the best team, that's sort of what it's about. So those are the nuts and bolts behind the technology that we've developed. When you're developing something that is truly cutting edge and hasn't been done before, you don't know exactly how it's going to turn out, you know? So that's always a bit of a challenge. I mean, we of course meet with the executives of the company once a month, give them status updates and let them know how things are going. But yeah, managing expectations about, you know, what can we deliver? How realistic is that? I would say in our manufacturing, we are, you know, we're quite agile, so to speak. I mean, of course, we have all of the standard manufacturing, you know, tact boards and all of these sorts of things. But I think when you work on something that's truly cutting edge, it elevates the standard. What used to be considered impressive, the goalposts move, you know, and then it raises everyone's game. This is fundamental technology now that we've developed that can be used for all sorts of different use cases in manufacturing. We've already highlighted many of those, and actually even extra functionality even onto this product. So it's a key enabler in that sense, and I would say it also sets the scene for actually how we develop these sorts of products in manufacturing. So with the Digital Venture Lab set up, with the relationships that we've now built and really nurtured across the business, between, you know, stakeholders in manufacturing, digital teams in India, supply relationships, etc. That really sets the scene for future development. The ways that we can continue developing on this technology is almost countless. One of the things that we were probably overly ambitious at the start of this project, you know. I think there's always a challenge when you're scoping where to draw the line for the MVP or the proof of concept. You know, on one side of the coin, you don't want to dampen the enthusiasm in the organization, and on the other side of the coin, you want to try and be as ambitious as possible. So I think where we drew the line for the proof of concept, which we completed in the summer of last year, we were probably overly ambitious with the different levels of features that we would develop for that. We mainly focused on one particular feature, but we probably should have pushed everything else off to the side and looked at that at a later stage. We realized too late that there were fundamental topics that we needed to cover. You know, for example, the I mean, it's quite technical, but let's say the partitioning of the edge devices, which, you know, it was in the early stages of the project, it was, you know, sort of make it up as you go along, and we'll fix that better later. Whereas if we had taken a bit more time and maybe moved a bit slower through some of those more fundamental topics, then we would have had a system that was that much more robust and didn't need resetting up once we got past the sort of learning phase. So I think it's a balance. I mean, on one side, you really want to develop quickly and move fast and fail quickly and learn from it. But that then, of course, then means that later on in the later phases of the project, you are having to rebuild quite a bit of stuff. So I think now we are at least much more aware of that. We balance that, and we're more aware of moving fast, but also not maybe moving so fast that we jeopardize the stability of something later on. Last year, or at least for the last 6 months, we've just been working on you know, making that more robust and more resilient and more stable. I don't think we underestimated the development work that was required in getting something production ready, but I still think, you know, it still amazes me when you know, the more you get down the development journey, the more details that come up, something like the frame rate of the camera, how, you know, not only does that then affect the computational requirements that you have, but also the networking, the power consumption maybe at the server room. So, you know, each one of these little things where you might develop a user story, and the knock-on effect of that is huge. When we have an update on one factory, we push that out to all the different factories. So sort of knowledge sharing and lessons learned and making all factories perform like the best, that's going to start to become much more normal in our business.
To learn more about the solutions that Siemens Gamesa implemented, be sure to check out their case study and other resources linked here, or visit azure.com for additional IoT solutions and services.